Joining us right now is Mehrab Irani, General Manager at Tata Investments Corporation. Mehrab, great to have you here with us. Thanks very much. We'll get to the markets in a bit, but I just want to talk about the new book that you've written. And I just want to sort of put that up, and we'll start with that today. This is called The 10 Commandments of Financial Freedom from Mehrab Irani. He's the General Manager Investments at Tata Investment Corporation Limited. The book's just out. It's out there on the shelves. You can check it out. Mehrab, I mean, how is this different from all the other self-help finance books out there in the market? And there are quite a few, right?
Right. Good afternoon, Prashant. Thank you for calling me. You are right. There are a lot of self-help and a lot of finance books available. So, but if you see, I have been working in the finance and investment field for the past 15 years. So what I have been seeing is that, you know, today we may be advancing very much technologically. Today information is available, everybody has access to information, etc. However, the financial knowledge is actually lacking. And more, you know, we are going towards some kind of financial slavery, what I would call. I think we are becoming wage slaves of the employer, tax slaves of the government, and loan slaves of the bank. Today, if you see the youth, the middle class, in a country like India, I think we are very much fortunate to have a large amount of middle class, and our demography is very favorable. However, if you see that we have to educate them on financial knowledge, that is very much which is lacking. Today, the youth may earn very good income, but what is happening is that more and more income they are utilizing to buy more and more liabilities which they think are assets, and actually they are incurring unnecessary expenditure on those items, and they keep full life working as slaves for money and never attain financial freedom. They are never able to properly invest the money, properly budget the money, protect their money, insure their money, and keep on working for money full life, and at the end of it they don't attain financial freedom. And my purpose of writing this book is that I brought out 10 commandments for financial freedom, which I believe that once somebody learns and accepts and understands them and applies them in their life, I think they would be able to attain financial freedom. And that is one,
how do you define financial freedom? What is financial freedom?
See, financial freedom is, I think, in my simple sentence will be, when we stop working for money and our money starts working for us.
Okay.
I think that is when we attain financial freedom, or may I call financial nirvana. I think that is the stage which every human being has to try to achieve.
And a lot of people and a lot of viewers would love to do that.
Yeah.
I mean, actually everybody does.
Right.
So how does one do it? I mean, you've got limited time here.
Right.
What are the big topics, broad areas that you cover in the book?
See, the number one thing the starting point is obviously earning income. And I cannot teach anybody how to earn income. I strongly believe God has given everybody some kind of gift. We have to just recognize and utilize that gift to start earning income. But the main problem starts that once we earn income, then we have to also understand that we have to earn income from the right source, from the right vehicle. Then we have to understand how to protect that income, because there are, you know, a lot of financial predators who are waiting for our income. It can be government, it can be bank, it can be a lot of other intermediaries, etc., which are waiting to pounce. So we have to protect our income from the legal financial predators. Then another important thing is budgeting. I think a lot of people forget to pay themselves. They are there, they are paying everybody, they are paying government via the taxes, they are paying interest to the banks, they are paying all the bills, but they forget to pay themselves. And if you don't budget properly, then whether it's the government or an individual, today we see world over the governments are in a lot of debt. What we see today, including the Indian, like if you see the fiscal deficit which is there, so this is because of lack of proper budgeting. So that is another thing at an individual level which we have to take care. Then we have to also think about the other things are investing, and while investing we have to invest in assets which actually create income for us. And many times we actually mistakenly buy liabilities thinking them to be assets. For example, a car though in accounting sense may be classified as in the balance sheet as an asset, but in sense it is a liability because it takes money from your pocket. It loses its value, you have to pay money for driver's salary, petrol bills, etc. So then we have to, the other thing is financial insurance. Insurance will be anything which actually helps you for staying in the business in what you are. And so that is another thing. Then there are a lot of other things like speculative items. You know, a lot of people go overboard investing in speculative items. A speculative item which I will define as would be something which doesn't give you income. A non-income generating thing would be a speculative item, because there you are only dependent on capital gains for it. So that will be a speculative item. So, you know, there are different commandments which I have put in the book, along with different rules of money. which I think once we follow, and I hope that it will help each and everybody to gain some kind of financial freedom.
You know, one thing which stands out and which I think we all don't do enough is essentially emphasize on asset allocation.
Right.
Right. I mean, we say this is the stock market.
Right.
I mean, you can buy A stock, B stock, C stock, D stock.
Correct.
I mean, take your pick.
Right.
But before that, I guess, I mean, you know, if you look at it top down, there is the broader, I mean, what do you do with your money?
Correct.
I mean, are stocks the only thing? I mean, absolutely no, right? I mean, you get that right, then you maybe are in the general right direction.
You are perfectly right. Actually, asset allocation is my first commandment. And I think that is the basic for any kind of financial planning. Mm-hmm. And if we see historically, it has been statistically proved that 90% of the portfolio variability is because of asset allocation. Mm-hmm. So if you get your asset allocation right, you have taken care of 90% of the portfolio variability. Mm-hmm. And that is what is lacking in most people. We all are going for the next hot investment advice or the idea, but not actual asset allocation. And asset allocation is actually very boring, a very mechanical process. Mm. It has to be done, it has not to be very interesting. It has to be planned, mechanical, and you have to just follow it. Mm. Yeah, that is the essence of it.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, you know, the books are on the shelves, right?
Yeah, the books are on the shelves. It's available on...
okay, great. Great. I mean, if you're interested, you can pick up a copy. This is 10 Commandments of Financial Freedom. Mehrab Irani is General Manager Investments at Tata Investment Corporation. So that's Mehrab's new book. So let's talk about asset allocation right now, Mehrab. I mean, what's your sense? Markets are where they are. Big recovery after the meltdown around the budget time.
Right.
What is your sense? I mean, are equities a good thing to look at this stage?
I think so. Equities are looking quite interesting, and the markets are poised very interestingly at this point of time. If you see the third quarter results, the top line grew by around 8%, while the bottom line growth was around 6%. And what we believe is, like, you know, it may be end of the earnings downgrade cycle, and hopefully it should be so. In the result, what was important, I think, is that the operating margin for a lot of companies expanded, and this was one positive thing. Also, the depreciation, I think that also increased, and that is one positive thing. It shows that, you know, some kind of capex is picking up in the overall industry. That is one positive. The thing which was a little, which worried me, was the interest expense. If you remove the banking companies, I think interest expense as a whole increased by almost 34%. So that was quite worrying, you know, on the background of when we are thinking about the interest rates coming down in the economy. Mm. So once that happens, and you know, the budget is now over, and though it was a non-event, but I don't think it was really a bad budget, and we have to see how the government carries on with its reforms and whether they are able to achieve that 4.8% deficit. Mm. And globally also, I think the scenario has been improving over the past few weeks, and global markets like the US Dow is also at an all-time high.
Right.
So, you know, all factors are reasonably positive. The valuations, we are valued 15 times forward earning, which is within the range.
Which is not crazy, I guess.
It is not crazy. It is not cheap, but it's not crazy also. Yeah. The ROE is around 17%. I think if you are able to, if the earnings is down, earnings is bottomed out, and if the ROE is strengthens from here, I think we have a good case for some continuation of this up move in the market.
Okay, got that. I trust that in the crash that we've seen, not crash, but a bit of a sell-off that we've seen, you've been buyers. You've been a buyer of stocks?
Yeah, we have been net buyers
over
yes.
Okay.